Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me okay? Is this,
yes, yeah.
My name is Graham Clark, as Andy's already said. I'm an ordinary member of North Kessock and District Local History Society, but I want to tell you about a project that we've now completed, and called Feats of Clay. A very complex project. It incorporated many different activities, and I can only give you a flavour of those. Many funders and many partners. The main funders are displayed on the slide, and I take this opportunity to acknowledge that funding, otherwise this project could never have happened. It all started back in 2010-12, when Headland Archaeology Limited were commissioned to undertake a pre-development housing pre-development survey of what was the farmland or Belfield farm just outside North Kessock. Previous aerial surveys had shown up crop marks that were obviously of some interest, so the site was known as a potential archaeological site. Headland found evidence in their early survey of early Iron Age, late Bronze Age settlement, as a result of which Historic Scotland requested some trial excavations. And here's the site. If you don't know where North Kessock is, it's over the Kessock Bridge from Inverness, and the site is shown in the right-hand diagram. During these excavations, Headland found fragments of clay molds, mainly for tools and weapons, depending whether you call an axe a tool or a weapon. Two examples here, one socketed an axe on the hence late Bronze Age on the top right picture, and a gouge mould in the bottom. And these were just two examples of several moulds that have been found, and in fact Headland never yet released its final report, so we don't know exactly how many moulds they found, but there was quite a lot of them. What really took the eye was this. This was a sickle mould. You can clearly see the outline of the blade. And this is a mould unique in the UK. A clay mould had never been found in the UK until this moment in time. So this was a very significant event. And as a result of that, North Kessock District Local History Society, and whose patch the excavation and the finds were made, were approached by Trevor Cowie, at that time principal curator of Bronze Age at the National Museum of Scotland, and wondering whether we might consider running a community project. Largely to inform the locals who already lived there and the ones who were about to live there, because this was a housing development, the significance of the site on which they were to be living, and trying to introduce some idea of how their predecessors on the site lived in the early Iron Age and late Bronze Age. So, we decided we would go ahead. We had run community projects before, so it didn't frighten us. We got very handsome Heritage Lottery funding, and Council funded it, and we set off. As I said earlier, I can only give you a flavour of some of the activities that took place, but the first thing we did was to commission Susan Cruz. Not sure if she's in the audience. No, I don't see her. Probably doesn't need to be. She knows all of this. We commissioned Susan, though, from Arch to do a course on Bronze Age for the interested locals. We then set off to the Highland Archives, where we pored over maps looking for references to where the clay for the moulds that were found might have come from. We also talked to a lot of the locals to see if they knew where there was local clay deposits and so on. So off we went after that with our buckets and spades. And there's a picture of Munlochy Bay, which is around the corner from North Kessock, and was obviously a candidate because it was well known as a clay, and you can see the clay and the footmarks in the picture. We collected samples from about half a dozen different possible areas. We then had these samples fired by a lady called Orlene McElfatrick, who's an expert in that kind of thing, filing. They were thin-sectioned, the little briquettes that she had fired, and they were sent to Stockholm, where somebody called Dr. Daniel Salon, who was an expert in photomicrography, and this was his picture of Munlochy fired clay, and was quite a good match for sections of the moulds that had been found. So we assumed, although it's not 100% certain, these things never can be, but it looks as though our Bronze Age ancestors got into their boats and paddled around the headland into Munlochy Bay to collect the clay for their metalworking. We engaged the schools. This is a class. This is Orlene in the blue jumper on the left hand side in a class from Fortrose Academy, and she's showing them how to make pots and fire them. And we also engaged the local primary school. And this is one picture that I've picked out because it shows Bronze Age forging going on. I'm not quite sure what the lady in the middle is doing. This is a primary school. They shouldn't really have been perhaps showing us that. But clearly the figures down below are melting metal and casting it. Of over 100 pupils in the school, every single one of them produced a picture like that of what they thought about Bronze Age after that Susan Cruz had gone along to the school to tell them about the Bronze Age. So maybe it was something Susan said. So those are the kinds of activities we undertook. And the whole thing culminated in 2014 in what we call the Crafting Day. And on the evening of Crafting Day, we invited Trevor Kelly, that's Trevor in the picture here, to come along and give us a talk. He called it Magic Metals, about Bronze Age and how bronze might be made in the settlement in North Kessock. And so that was in the evening beforehand and during Crafting Day, and I'll just let this run, some pictures of the kinds of activities that were going on in the village hall. And you can see Orlene in the bottom right hand corner doing her pots, bread making, green carving, basket weaving and so on, all the sorts of things that would have been going on in the settlement of North Kessock in the Bronze Age. But the guy who was the star of the show and was intended to be was this man, Neil Burrish. Some of you may have heard of him, the only professional bronze caster who makes his living from casting bronze in the UK. And again, some slides just to show you, this is him getting a bit of help in pouring the molten bronze. And the left hand side is a sickle that he was just about to take out of his mould. He used sand moulds, by the way. And in the top centre is a lady called Kay Burton, one of our project team, proudly holding a sword that Neil had cast on that day as well. We have that sword in our possession. So the next stage, and almost the sort of second phase of the project, is that we wanted to do some research and photography and so on. The reason being that we wanted to create a permanent record of the project and in the form of a book. And so we wanted to research all the bronze finds there had been, at least there had been recorded from around the Murray Firth area to get these all catalogued and if possible to find an image. If there wasn't an image we could beg, borrow or steal, then we would take our own image. So to set this going, we again commissioned Susan to tell us, we want to do this research, how do we do it? Where are we going to find information about all the finds of bronze metalwork that had been discovered over the years around the Murray Firth? Well, we learned a lot. And so we set off, first of all, into the museums. Here we are kind of practicing our photographic skills and on the block. At the bottom is a very fine bronze razor. And here is us trying to photograph it. It was very finely etched. And we knew we were getting pretty good at photography. We could get great picture with the etchings on it. And this was all in preparation of going off to Trevor in the National Museum to photograph all the bits of Murray Firth metalwork, bronze metalwork, that Trevor could find in the museum. So that was quite a long phase. All the research and so on included visits to the Ashmolean, who held some pieces in Oxford, to the British Museum, who had several pieces. Cambridge University had some pieces. Amazing where Bronze Age metalwork from Murray Firth finished up. And a wonderful sword in Berlin. But unfortunately, the Heritage Lottery Fund wasn't prepared to send me, although I was very happy to go to photograph a wonderful sword that's in Berlin. Anyway, we got a picture of it from Berlin, and that's what was saying this. So the project finished with a book launch and a final exhibition about the whole project. Once again, we invited Trevor up to give us a talk, this time about Bronze Age in the Highlands. And here he is performing that talk. And then we went to the book launch. Oh, where's the book? Unfortunately, we hadn't hit the deadline. It took us a bit longer to find all the bronze, and it took us a bit longer to put the words on the pages. So anyway, we decided to go ahead with the final exhibition anyway. And again, there were various activities. Here's some weaving and pottery making outside, a simple fire. Various exhibits about the project at that exhibition. Anyway, although the bad news was that we didn't manage to hit the deadline for the book. The book is now published. I've got a copy of it here. It's just to prove that it is real. It was published earlier this year. There's 65 pages in it. It cost £7.50, and I just happen to have a briefcase full of them. If anybody wants to approach me, then £7.50. Maybe we can do you a deal, but you'll have to make a good case. It essentially contains three chapters. One is a resume of the whole project that I've tried to very briefly show you. There is an essay on how the Bronze Age, how people lived in the Bronze Age in the Highlands, and in particular near North Kessock. And there is a catalogue of the Bronze Age metalwork from around the Murray Firth. Just briefly, the contents of the catalogue takes up about 60% of the book. There's 40 pages of catalogue. This is a kind of typical page. This is the page for late Bronze Age axe heads from Ross and Cromarty. Just as a kind of sample of the catalogue page. In all, we discovered 162 objects that had been discovered from the area, and there's a breakdown there, mostly tools, a few weapons, spears and swords, some ornaments, a few miscellaneous lumps of bronze, and seven of those were other moulds. In the book there are also five maps showing the distribution of the one I'm showing you here is the distribution of all the pieces according to whether they're late, early or middle Bronze Age. Just an insight into the information that we've included in the catalogue for each item and the seven headings that we tried to get information on for every single one. Obviously, it wasn't possible to find all the information for every page. You might be interested, though, that the 162 pieces are distributed around 14 museums. I mentioned most of them. 124 of the items are still in Scotland. The others are mainly in England, in Wales, and that one in Berlin. 21 of them have been lost. So we never actually handled 21 of them. They've disappeared for all sorts of reasons, no doubt. And that does mean that some of them, we don't have images. In fact, we don't have images for 17 of those lost ones. There are images in existence for the other four. So, just to summarise, this was a very much a partnership, an innovative approach to community archaeology. It was about bringing a developer-led excavation into the local community, explaining to them what they were doing and what they had found. It was very broad-ranging, it was very inclusive, all sorts of people were involved, as I hope I've shown you. Not just the North Kessock community, but lots of craftsmen, the schools, academics, and all the local museums and libraries and archives. Lots of interlocked activity, community events, as I've showed you, outdoor explorations, museum work, research going on. Very much raising awareness about the local heritage on their doorstep, and of course exactly those who live in the new houses that are now there, is very much under their doorstep, if not on it. And there are some permanent legacies from the project. Obviously the photographic archive, there's also a master research file that's got all the information we gathered about every single piece in that. The Feats of Clay book, of course, that I've just shown you, and some replica bronze castings, which I showed you one, and in fact the three. We have a sickle, a sword, and a spearhead that were produced during crafting day. I just happened to have the sickle with me. It had a handle hoot on it. This is the very one that Neil Burridge produced on crafting day. Well, come on, look at it, as long as you don't wield it too much. So thank you very much. I hope you've enjoyed hearing about our project. Thank you.